Good morning po sa lahat ng mga criminology students, especially sa mga kadete natin sa Foundation University, pati na sa Cebu Institute of Technology or CITU, sa lahat ng nagre-review online for the upcoming criminology licensure examination under the new curriculum na po tayo, sa lahat ng mga instructors, part-time, tsaka yung mga regular instructors sa criminology, pati na yung mga enthusiast sa criminology profession. Magandang araw po sa inyo. The discussion in this episode will concentrate in one of the subjects under CDI, ang tinatawag po nating Fundamentals of Criminal Investigation with Police Intelligence. Take note po sa nagre-review, ang dalawang subjects po are merged into one. Itong criminal investigation tsaka yung police intelligence. Kasi sa old curriculum po, ang dalawang subjects na ito are separated. Iba po yung Fundamentals of Criminal Investigation tsaka iba din yung police intelligence under the old curriculum. Pero sa new curriculum po, take note, sa nagre-review online, these two subjects are merged into one. Also, I would like to emphasize na lahat ng topics na i-discuss natin ngayon are aligned with PRC and CHED recommended course description or course content. So basically, there's a big possibility po na marami ang lalabas kasi naka-align na po ito sa PRC at saka sa CHED. Ka-advise ko lang po sa mga criminology students who will be taking the CLE. Pag nakapasa po kayo, ang una nyo pong pasalamatan isang Panginoon. Because without God, we are nothing. Pangalawa po, dapat natin pasalamatan yung mga magulang natin, yung parents natin who exerted a lot of effort para makapag-enroll tayo sa criminology program. Pangatlo po, pagtapos na po tayo nagbigay ng pasalamat sa Panginoon tsaka yung sa mga magulang natin, dapat pasalamatan din po natin yung eskwelahan kung saan tayo nanggaling. Because the university or the college where we come from give us the foundation, okay? A strong foundation for us to hurdle the criminology licensure examination. Lahat po ng mga lessons tsaka yung mga discussion, ang foundations po dyan, nagmula po sa eskwelahan natin. Ang review center, ang role po ng review center is to enhance lang po, to enhance or to supplement yung knowledge natin na nakukuha from the university or from the college where we came from. So dapat ang pagpasalamat sa review center, pang-apat lang po yan. Dapat unahin po natin ang Panginoon, magulang natin, tsaka yung institution that we come from. Sa lahat naman ng mga review centers dyan, dapat po we should not grab credit in terms of the successes of our reviewees. Okay, of our reviewees. So dapat ang success po should be attributed first sa effort ng eskwelahan. So dapat pang-apat lang po tayo. So pag nakapasa po yung mga reviewers natin, dapat advice natin na magpasalamat din po sila sa eskwelahan, sa magulang tsaka yung sa Panginoon. Kasi yung role po natin is only enhancement. Okay? Or supplement lang po tayo sa lahat ng mga learnings na nakukuha ng mga bata from the university or from the school where they came from. Now, without further ado, punta na po tayo sa proper discussion natin. Unahin po natin ang definition ng criminal investigation. Ang pinaka-basic po na definition ng criminal investigation is ganito. It is an art which deals with the identity and location of the offender and provides evidence of guilt through criminal proceedings. So, pansin niyo po sa definition, ang purpose po ng criminal investigation are threefold po. Una, to identify the perpetrator or to identify the guilty party. Pangalawa, pag na-identify na po yung perpetrator, The criminal investigator has to locate and arrest the guilty party or to locate and arrest the perpetrator. Ang pangatlo, last na role ng criminal investigation is to provide evidence for his guilt. Now, ang tatlong folds po na ito ay tinatawag na three aims of criminal investigation. Or sometimes this is referred to as the phases of criminal investigation. So, if in the board examination, nag-mention po ng word na phases of criminal investigation. Ibig sabihin po, phases, this refers to the aims or the goals or the stages of criminal investigation. Ano ba itong mga stages, phases, or aims ng criminal investigation? I repeat, una, to identify the perpetrator. Number two, to locate and arrest the perpetrator. And number three, ang pinakalast po, to provide evidence or evidences to support his guilt. So, ang tatlong aims po na yan, yan po ang nag-contain sa definition ng criminal investigation. So, again, ibig sabihin ng criminal investigation, this is the process which deals with identifying the perpetrator, the arrest or the location of the perpetrator, and providing evidences to support the guilt of the perpetrator. So, basically, ang tao or the person charged in carrying the functions of criminal investigation is known as the criminal investigator. Now, the question right now is, how can the criminal investigator accomplish these three stages or three phases of criminal investigation? Paano ba? Paano ba ma-accomplish itong mga stages na to? Ang sagot po dyan, these stages can be accomplished if the investigator can fulfill his primary job. So ano po bang primary job ng criminal investigator? Ang primary job ng criminal investigator is on the accomplishment of what we call as the cardinal points of criminal investigation, or simply, the cardinal points of investigation. Ano ba itong cardinal points of investigation? Ang cardinal points of investigation comprises 5 W's. We call it as 5 wives. And 1 H or 1 husband. So basically, how many points in the cardinal points of investigation? Ilan ba lahat? 6 po yan. 5 wives, tsaka yung isa, 1 husband. 5 W's, 1 H. Now, ano ba itong 5 W's? Okay? Ano ba itong 5 W's? This 5 W's, review lang po natin. Itong 5 W's na to refers to what, where, when, whom, and why. So, in what, you have to, as the investigator, you have to determine what specific offense was committed, where the crime was committed, when was the crime committed, who are the persons involved? Why the crime is committed? So if we say what crime is committed, that refers to the nature of the crime. So dapat alam mo po yan pag ikaw ay isang police officer. Anong particular provision of the law that was been violated? What is the nature of the crime? Pangalawa, yung where would refer to the location or the place where the offense was committed. Pangatlo, yung when would refer to the approximate time. Okay? Yung estimated time na nangyari yung krimen. Yung who or whom naman would refers to the persons, either the perpetrators or the victims who are involved in the commission of the crime. Yung panglast, yung why, would refer to the motivating factor that causes the perpetrator to commit the crime. Baka hatred yan. Baka vengeance yan. Baka jealousy. So what are the reasons behind why the person committed the crime? So when we say why, that refers to the reason or the motive for the commission of the crime. Yung last naman, yung husband, yung H, how that refers to the modus operandi. Okay, or the mode of operation. How the crime was committed. Yan po ang 6 cardinal points of investigation. Now, marami pong qualities dapat ang investigator. Sa mga nagre-review right now, maybe if you pass by God's, you know, by God's blessing, you will pass the criminology licensure exam. Naging police officer ka, dapat po, pag na-assign ka sa criminal investigation, dapat you must have a lot of virtues within you. Good qualities that you can utilize for the success of the criminal investigation. Itong makikita nyo sa slide, kukunti lang po yan. Kukunti lang po yan. Yan po ang pinaka-common. Marami po tayong qualities, pero yan po ang pinaka-common. Yung perseverance, ano ba ibig sabihin ng perseverance? Ibig sabihin dyan, may effort ka. Nasustain mo yung effort despite the difficulties. Kasi minsan, yung krimen po natin is very complex. Dapat you have to decipher po sa krimen. Okay? Because it's a very complicated puzzle that you have to solve. So even though it is difficult, nasustain mo yung effort. You still continue the effort of criminal investigation. Kahit medyo difficult po yung task. That's what we call as perseverance. Number 2, yung intelligence, which is very, very important po. Without the skills po, okay, without the skills and the knowledge in criminal investigation, patay po tayo. Yung criminal investigation na yan would be a failure. Pag walang knowledge po on the part of the criminal investigator, dapat po intelligent po tayo. Pangatlo, yung honesty po natin. Ibig sabihin ng honesty po, dapat credible po yung performance natin sa criminal investigation. Hindi po pwedeng maging ano na lang, planting of evidence. Diba? Sa mga kadete natin dyan, who are aiming to become police officer, take note po, dapat honest po tayo in our dealings. So in criminal investigation, dapat yung facts, the truth, should be the aspects that will be asserted during our report to the court of justice. Dapat po, wala po tayong ano, alteration, planting of evidence, which is very common. Pang-apat naman po yung tinatawag nating keen power of observation. Yung si keen power of observation po, this refers to our ability to notice and pay close attention to things. For example, pagpunta nyo po sa bahay ng biktima, nakikita nyo po na sira yung ano, doorknob. So the destruction of the doorknob could be an indication that there is burglary being committed. So yung mga ganyang mga detalye, okay? Mga ganyang detalye, it needs keen power on the part of the investigator para makuha po yung ebidensya na magagamit natin sa korte in bringing the accused into justice. Now, sa types of criminal investigations naman, marami din po tayong types. But what you can see on the slide right now are the most common ones. For example, yung pinakauna na type po dyan is homicide investigation. So, basically, pag ibig sabihin dyan, homicide, this refers to the investigation that involves killing a person. So, homicide investigation. By the way, sa mga kadete natin dyan na mag-take ng criminology licensure examination, dapat we have to be careful po sa mga keywords. Okay? May mga keywords po ang mga tanong sa board examination. Ito po ang magbibigay clues on our part para makuha po natin yung answer. For example, homicide. So, pag ang tanong is on type of investigation, tapos it involves killing, so basically, it's about homicide investigation. Pangalawa, if in case the investigation involves computer crimes, such as identity theft, illegal firearm sales, online drug trafficking, money laundering, cyberbullying, if computer is involved, ang tawag po dyan is cybercrime investigation. On the other hand, yung forensic investigation naman is an investigation involving scientific examination or analysis of evidences. For example, yung urine or yung DNA or yung blood or yung semen coming from the person being examined in the crime laboratory, part po yan ng tinatawag nating forensic investigation. Mayroon din tayong tinatawag na fraud investigation. So when you say fraud, this involves false information to scam, okay? To scam a person or a company. Next po ang tinatawag nating family and sexual violence investigation. Ito po ang type na investigation that involves domestic abuse, sexual assault, and child abuse or neglect. Another one is crimes against property. So crimes against property, ang malagay po sa isip natin, yung robbery, yung theft. Okay? Yung theft. So basically, when you say criminal crimes against property investigation, ito po yung investigation that involves burglary, theft, or even vandalism. Now, ang cold cases, ibig sabihin ng cold cases, ito po yung mga unsolved, okay? Unsolved criminal investigation which remains open pending the discovery of the evidence. So pag naka-encounter po kayo sa board examination ng words na cold cases, ibig sabihin dyan, ito po yung mga kaso that remains to be unsolved and are waiting for evidences or the discovery of the new evidences. So when you say cold cases, ito po yung mga investigations that involves reviewing the past evidence, searching for new clues, and using updated forensic technology so that justice can hopefully be served no matter how much time has passed. Ang last, pag ang investigation involves drugs, okay? Drug-related po yung investigation. Ang tawag po dyan, narcotic investigation. So, ang mga types na to, ito po yung very common. Pero marami pa po tayong types sa criminal investigation. But what you can see on the slides are the most common ones that we can use as best information in the board exam. Now, let us go now to the initial steps in criminal investigation. Very understandable po ito, mga cadets. Una, identify, tsaka if possible, retain for questioning yung tao na nag-report, okay, or nag-notify sa police. Pangalawa, you have to determine the identity of the perpetrator. Okay? Identify the name or determine the identity of the perpetrator. If in case you are done identifying the perpetrator, dapat you have to observe po. You have to observe his behaviors or you have to observe him. Letter C, detain all persons present at the scene. Bakit kailangan pong i-detain? Kasi po, ang mga persons present at the scene might give you relevant information that can help solve the crime puzzle. Letter D, summon assistance if necessary. So, kailangan po, if you need assistance from ordinary citizens, especially in the cordoning of the area, pag kailangan po ng tulong from ordinary citizens, pwede po. Next, safeguard the area by physically isolating it. Ito po ang pinaka-importante. Ang role ng first responder is as much as possible, the area should be well-preserved. Now, how will you preserve the area? How will you isolate it? You can isolate it by putting a cordon, cordoning the area. Ang tanong ngayon is, what if, sir, there is no cordon? Or the police officers failed to bring with him a cordon. So pag walang cordon po, pwede po, according to the manual in the criminal investigation at saka yung sa POP or police operational procedure, pwede po you can put barricades like tables, chairs, or anything that can isolate the crime scene from the outside surroundings. Next is, subsequently permit only authorized person to enter the area. Authorized lang po. Kasi pag you allow somebody to enter the crime scene, that somebody might contaminate the evidences that are inside. So, in as much as possible, only persons who are authorized, okay, who are authorized to enter the crime scene. Next, separate the witnesses in order to obtain independent statements. Ano po ba ang reason why do we have to separate witnesses? Number one po, para ang testimony natin, yung statements na makukuha natin is independent. Ano ba ibig sabihin ng independent? Ibig sabihin ng independent, meaning, yung statement by the witness is not a replication or a duplication of the testimony of the other witness. Kasi ang mangyayari po dyan, if you put in an interview the two witnesses in one area, ang mangyayari po, the first witness might only duplicate or replicate the statements of the other witness. So in order for you to have independency in terms of the testimony, dapat po separated yung pag-interview natin sa mga witnesses. Next, golden rule po ito, do not touch or move any object. Discuss po natin yan sa next slide. And lastly, definitely assign the duties of the search of assistance are present. So ito po yung mga initial steps in criminal investigation. Now again, punta po tayo sa do not touch or move any object. Ang tanong po dito, what should then be the primary job of an investigator before applying this rule? Ang do not touch or move any object, tinatawag po yung MAC rule. MAC, MAC rule. Ano po bang ibig sabihin ng MAC? Ibig sabihin ng MAC, do not move, alter, or change the crime scene. Take note po ha, MAC. Do not move, or alter, or change the crime scene. MAC rule po ang tawag dyan. Do not touch or move any object. But the question right now again is, what should be the primary job of the investigator before applying this rule? Nakalagay po dyan. Binigyan ko po ng answers. Una, ganito po. If the victim is alive, okay? If the victim is alive, the investigator should gather information from the victim while calling the assistance of an ambulance. If the victim is alive. Then after you got the statements and the victim has already been removed and is brought to the hospital, that's the time that the measurement, the sketch, and the photograph of the crime scene are taken. Klarong-klaro po ha. Again, pag buhay po yung biktima, ang gawin mo po, okay, baka lalabas to ha sa board exam, pag buhay po yung biktima, ang gagawin mo is to gather information while calling for an ambulance. Number two, pag nandyan na ang ambulance, tapos the victim has already been taken away and has been brought to the hospital, dyan na po mangyayari ang measurement, yung sketch natin, tsaka yung photograph. Now, ang tanong, what if the victim is already dead? Patay na po yung biktima. Pag patay na po yung biktima, ang gagawin po is sketch muna tayo, measurement muna tayo, photograph muna tayo. After that, tapos na po sa sketch, tapos na po sa photograph, tapos na po sa measurement, dyan na po pwedeng i-remove yung dead body ng biktima. Pag patay na po. Okay? I hope that is very clear, cadet. I hope that is very clear. So again, pag patay na po yung biktima, the body should be removed only after the crime scene is measured, sketch and photograph. Next, sa criminal investigation, pinaka-common po ito, yung tools of investigation. Okay? Very common, cadets. Actually, sa PRC, tsaka yung sa CHED course contents, it usually highlighted on the tools of investigation. So, posible po, marami pong posibilidad na lalabas po itong three I's. Ang tools of investigation, as I have said, are also known as three I's. I, letter I. Tatlong I's of investigation. ice in a sense that every first letter start with every first letter of the word starts with letter I. So information, interview, instrumentation. We will discuss this exhaustively po. Now, unahin po natin ang information. Ang information as the first tool or the first eye of criminal investigation refers to the knowledge or the data which an investigator acquires from records and persons. Regular source is acquired from open sources, records, files. Cultivated sources are information furnished by informants, informers. Grapevine source are information given by the underworld characters such as prisoners or criminals. Now, before i-differentiate natin kung anong ibig sabihin ng regular source, cultivated source, tsaka yung grapevine source, we will classify first information into two general types. Dalawa lang po ang general types ng information. Una, yung overt information. Pangalawa, yung covert information. Ano bang ibig sabihin ng overt information? When we say overt, from the word overt, meaning these are information obtained through open sources. Open sources, ha? Overt. Covert, on the other hand, from the word cover. Dapat ito po ang mga clues na makatutulong sa atin. Covert information, meaning these are information obtained through closed sources. For example, surveillance. Closed sources po yan. So, covert information. So again, overt, open, yung covert, closed sources. Now, yung specific types of information naman, itong tatlo na to, yung regular source. Ano ba ibig sabihin ng regular source? Yung open sources pa rin po. Yung, for example, if you get an information coming from the newspaper, open source po yan. So ano tawag? Regular source. Pangalawa, yung cultivated source of information. Ano ba ibig sabihin ng cultivated source of information? Ito po yung information obtained from informants tsaka yung informers. Ang tanong ngayon, what is the difference between informants and informer? Ibig sabihin ng informer, these are persons who gives information in exchange of money. Alright? Informer, these are persons who gives information in exchange of money. Informant, on the other hand, these are persons who gives information without expecting monetary values. So yan po ang difference between the two. So ibig sabihin ng cultivated source of information, ito po yung information galing sa informant saka yung sa informer. Yung pangatlo po, yung grapevine source, ito po yung mga information taken from underworld characters. For example, yung mga criminals natin, kumuha tayo ng information sa kanila. Yung mga prisoners natin, kumuha tayo ng information sa kanila. Yung mga gang members. So, yung mga information na yan ay tinatawag na grapevine sources. Now, ang pangalawang IPO or pangalawang tool of investigation, ang tinatawag nating interview. Later on, differentiate po natin anong pinagkaiba ng interview tsaka yung interrogation. Okay? Pero punta muna tayo sa interview. Ang interview po as the second tool of investigation is considered as the process of questioning. Questioning a person who is cooperating. Dapat nakakooperate po yung tao. Okay? The purpose of the line of questioning is to obtain information. Okay? Sa definition na makikita nyo sa slide, okay? Ang definition na makikita nyo sa slide, ang interview is basically on finding information about what was done, what was seen, felt, heard, tasted, smelled, or known by the interviewee. When you say interviewee, yung taong tinatanong. This is the questioning of a person believed to possess knowledge that is in official interest to the investigator. But you have to put in mind, pag interview po, ang interviewee or ang person that is subject to questioning is cooperating. Now, ang interview is applicable po siya sa mga witnesses. Okay? Applicable po ha sa witnesses. Later on, we will again talk about interrogation. Malalaman nyo later on that interrogation is different from interview. Now, ano bang purpose ng interview? Again, to obtain information coming from the subject. Take note po that the basic assumption in the interview is that nobody has to talk to law enforcers. When I say nobody has to talk to law enforcers, I am referring to the right. The right as embodied under the Philippine Constitution of a particular person not to cooperate in the line of questioning. The person has the right to remain silent po. So pag ang tao will not concede on your request, on the process of the interview, wala po tayong magawa kasi karapatan po yan ng subject. Pero in as much as possible, because the police officers cannot compel anybody to talk, dapat po ang police officer should be a person who can persuade. Okay? Who can persuade, of course, within legal and ethical limits to talk with the law enforcers. That is why yung criminal investigation tinatawag yung RT po yan. Yung interview, that is part of criminal investigation, RT po yan. Kasi it is your job as a criminal investigator to make or to establish necessary tactics or methodologies just to convince anyone to talk. So again, review po natin yung interview para po yan sa mga witnesses who are believed to cooperate in the line of questioning. Now, in addition po, sa criminal investigation, may tinatawag po tayong ironic format. Okay? Ironic format po. Okay, dapat you can memorize this abbreviation. When you say ironic, this refers to identity, rapport, opening statement, narration, I stands for inquiry. The last one is on conclusion. So when you say identity, prior to the commencement of an interview, the investigator should identify himself, his name, his rank, his designation. Dapat po, the investigator has to present himself to the subject. Ang ibig sabihin po ng rapport is yung connection nyo po, connection from the criminal investigator towards the person being interviewed. If there is already a connection, a positive feeling between the investigator and the subject, pwede po opening statement. When you say opening statement, the investigator must have to indicate why the subject is being contracted or why the subject has been the point for the interview or the subject for the interview. Tapos, letter N, narration. When you see narration, the witness should be allowed to tell all he knows with little interruption from the investigator. Meaning, when you see narration, you allow the witness to tell the story with little interruption lang po. When you see little interruption, you might ask about repeating the statement but not necessarily rebutting or arguing with the statement. You allow the witness to tell the story. Next would be the questioning. Pagtapos na po yung narration, dyan na po take ng opportunity to question the interviewee. Yan, ang tinatawag po sa stage na yan is inquiry. Pagtapos na po lahat, you can now proceed with the conclusion. Now, take note po sa ironic format, okay? Sa ironic format po, dapat we have to understand the general rules in questioning. The general rules in questioning is that there should be one question at a time. So, when we say one question at a time, this is a process of giving the subject the opportunity to state the story, to describe the story in his own perspective. Dapat hindi po sunod-sunod yung question. Dapat one question at a time po. On the other hand, dapat you should avoid the implied answers and questions have to be simple. And questions should be open-ended. Hindi po dapat close-ended. Kasi kapag close-ended po yan, when you say close-ended questions, this refers to the questions answerable by yes or no. Dapat open-ended po. For example, you will ask the subject, can you describe what happened? That's an open-ended question. But if you will ask the individual, like, did you witness the crime? Yes or no? That's a closed type of question. And it only constricts or it only isolate very limited information. So, dapat open-ended question po ang ibibigay natin in the line of questioning. Now, as I have stated a while ago, we need to differentiate the two, interview at saka yung interrogation. Again, ang interview is a line of questioning to the person who is cooperating. Okay? And the interview is only applicable to witnesses po. Sa nagre-review dyan, ang interview po is para sa mga witnesses. Yung interrogation naman is para sa mga suspect. Okay? Perpetrators or accused. Again, yung interview is applicable to the witnesses. Yung interrogation naman is a line of questioning. Pare-pareho lang din po sa interview. Pero ang interrogation is a line of questioning intended for the suspects. Now, mayroon po tayong legal requirements of interrogation. The statement of the subject must be obtained voluntary and trustworthy and not by means or use of threat, fear, coercion, duress, or any improper tactics which will vitiate the free will of the subject. Remember Republic 7438. What is Republic 7438? This is the law that contains the rights of the accused under custodial investigation. I-discuss po natin mamaya ang custodial investigation. Now, ibig sabihin ng legal requirements ganito po. Diba, may Miranda rights po tayo. Diba? The right to remain silent, the right to counsel, the right to be informed of the nature and cause of accusation. Punta tayo sa the right to remain silent. If the accused or the perpetrator will refuse to talk, problema po tayo. If he will refuse to talk, problema po tayo. Why? Because that will create hassle on our part in the process of solving the crime. However, we have to think also at the other side that refusal to talk is one of the constitutional rights of the accused. So, in reality, wala po tayong magawa if the accused will remain silent throughout the process of the criminal investigation. Why? Because that is his right. Now, if a person has been subjected to brutal experience, for example, what you do is to intimidate him. I-intimidate mo or you committed police brutality and the person talked after because of the pain and the suffering he experienced. So, nag-confess yung criminal or yung accused. Yung accused or perpetrator nag-confess. So, ano mangyayari sa confession? Ang mangyayari dyan, lahat ng statements that was taken from the accused is considered to be inadmissible. Kasi ang mga yan ay makonsider po yan na fruit of the poisonous tree. Ang ibig sabihin po ng fruit of the poisonous tree, these are evidences that can be considered as inadmissible in court because it was obtained illegally. So if you subjected him with police brutality just for him to confess, although you have the confession or the statement coming from the subject, still, it cannot be used as an evidence. So, dapat po, it has to be voluntary. Now, ang interrogation po ay mangyayari po dyan is that it has to be conducted in what we call as an interrogation room. Sa interrogation room po, yan. Now, take note, ang setup po sa interrogation room, ganito po, sa nagre-review right now. Dapat po ang interrogation room is simple without unnecessary furniture. Dapat lang po yung minimum requirements lang po na furniture ang dapat na sa loob. For example, the table and the chair should be the minimum requirements of furnitures that should be inside the interrogation room. Take note also na ang interrogation room may technical aid po yan. Meaning, it should be installed with a recording device and a one-way mirror. Yan po ang setup sa tinatawag nating interrogation room. Now, in interrogation, same with the interview, may arte po yan. Okay? Para you can have the volition or voluntariness on the part of the subject to confess or to make a statement, dapat may arte ka po. Kaya may tinatawag tayong interrogation techniques. Okay? Remember, these interrogation techniques are legal. Legal po ito. Kasi yung pagbigay ng statement is voluntary. Ang una po na technique is ang tinatawag nating emotional appeal. Pangalawa, yung sympathetic appeal. Now, ang emotional appeal, this means as the investigator, you analyze the subject's personality. Once you are done analyzing the personality of the subject, you decide what motivation would prompt him to tell the truth. Meaning, you observe him, dito na po kailanganin yung keen power of observation mo as a criminal investigator. Try to find out his personality and try to create a methodology or a tactic that is suitable to his personality. For example, punta tayo sa sympathetic appeal. If in case upon observation, you deemed sympathy as a good instrument for that person to talk, then use sympathy. That is why we have the so-called sympathetic appeal. Why? Because in sympathetic appeal, you utilize sympathy or friendship. Okay? Sympathy or friendship with the subject. Because if there is a gesture of friendship, there might be a probability that the person will cooperate with the line of questioning. Why? Because sometimes sympathy, friendship are something that could create a conducive atmosphere for the person to give a statement. So, ang emotional appeal requires you to analyze the personality of the subject. After analyzing, you make it an approach suitable to that personality. And on the other hand, if you find sympathy as one of the suitable approach, then go with a sympathetic appeal where you established friendship, gesture of friendship with the suspect. Now, the other interrogation techniques are kindness. Ang kindness po, tinatawag po yung simplest technique. Okay? Simplest technique wherein the investigator tend to be kind and friendly in his approach with the suspect. Pinakasimple po, ang tinatawag na simplest technique in the interrogation, among the interrogation techniques, kindness ang sagot. Pangalawa, extenuation. Extenuation po, the investigator indicates he does not consider the subject's indiscretion a grave offense. So basically, when we say extenuation, you tend to reduce the guilt being felt by the suspect. You tend to You tend to mitigate the implication of the act. Okay? You might say like, the crime you have committed is okay, that is fine. It does not affect the whole society in general. So, tawag po dyan is extenuation. You tend to mitigate or you tend to reduce the implication of the crime. Kasi pag na-reduce po yung implication ng krimen, baka you have the probability that the suspect will feel comfortable to speak or comfortable to confess. The other one is shifting the blame. Shifting the blame is very simple to understand. Meaning, you transfer the blame to the other individual, or you simply transfer the blame to other aspect. So maybe you ask the investigator, if the suspect is a drug addict, maybe, or a drug pusher, maybe you shift the blame to the government. Or maybe you shift the blame to poverty. And by shifting the blame, it could create the conducive environment or conducive atmosphere for the person to talk. Next would be Matt and Jeff. I want you to remember this one. Matt and Jeff po. Dalawa pong characters ang involved sa interrogation technique na ito. Si Matt, tsaka yung si Jeff. Ang character ni Matt, police officers po to ha, meaning dalawang police officers, dalawang interrogators po ang naka-assign. Ang unang officer will play the role of Matt. Sino ba yung Matt? Yung Matt po, ito po yung a bad investigator, a relentless investigator who is not going to waste any time because he knows the subject is guilty. Meaning, ito po yung pinaka-stricto. Maybe this is the person who will shout in front of the suspect. Pero itong si Jeff naman is the most kind-hearted between the two. The kind-hearted among the two. So si Matt yung stricto. Si Jeff naman yung very kind. Ang una pong ma-confront ng suspect is si Matt. Maybe yung police officer playing the role of Matt might shout, might do jolting, might do anything in rage. Pwede po yan. Matt po. But after Matt will go out, yung pangalawang police officer that will play the role of Jeff will come in. And he will play an emotional or a sympathetic or a friendly approach to the suspect. In that case, the effect would be the suspect might not confess to Matt, but there might be a possibility that the suspect will confess to Jeff because of the friendly approach. And that friendly approach of Jeff could be something that could establish connection, that could persuade the person to talk. Now, ang isa naman dito is ang tinatawag nating bluff on a split pair. This is applicable when there are more than one suspect. Take note, in this bluff on a split pair, the suspect are separated and one is informed that the other has talked. So this actually happened in real life. For example, when I was still a part-time instructor in one of the colleges or universities in Negros Oriental, kasi I was very strict in taking the examination. May dalawa pong estudyante, kadete. May dalawa pong estudyante did not take the midterm examination. And I know, because one of the practices in the people in Negros Oriental is that if there is a fiesta, everybody will attend. But usually during fiesta, wala pong cancellation ng klase. Tapos ang nangyari doon, ang midterm examination was actually scheduled during the fiesta, but we do not have any choice but to mandate the students to take the midterm examination. So ang nangyari po, dalawa po ang nag-absent. So yung isa ang sabi ng isa, sir, we were not able to cope up with the time because we had a flat tire. Yung passenger ko, yung isa namang kadete. Ang tanong ko sa isang kadete, ano nangyari? Flat tire, sir. So, ang ginawa ko, yung dalawang kadete, separate ko sila. I separate them into rooms. Okay? I separate them into rooms. And, you know, employ this kind of method, bluff on a split pair. So, ang sabi ko, pumunta ako sa isa. Ang sabi ko sa isa, the question was very simple. One question only. Saang gulong po ang naka-flat tire? Front tire? Kasi motorcycle eh. Front tire or the back tire? Saan pong tire? So sabi ng isa, and I know he was lying on that price, sabi niya, ano sir, front tire. Front tire po yung naka-flat. So, okay, are you sure it's the front tire? Sabi niya, yes, sir, I'm very sure it's the front tire. So, pagkatapos niyan, just one question only, I go out and I move to the other guy, considered as the passenger in the motorcycle. So, I ask him, sabi ng kasama mo, nagka-flat tire daw, ang tire na na-flat is yung back portion, back tire po. Pero ang sabi nung isa is actually front. But I said to him, sabi niya, back tire daw ang nagka-flat. So, ano ba talaga ang sa'yo? Front tire or back tire? So, sabi niya, yes, yes, sir, it's really back tire. So, sabi niya, back tire po, sir. Sir, I agree with my buddy. Back tire po yung nag-flat. So, there, by listening to the answer of the second guy, I found out and I confirmed that these two persons were actually lying. And that is one of the reasons why they had incomplete remark in the subject. So, yung bluff and split pair po, very essential po ito. Pag again, dalawa yung suspects natin or tatlo yung suspects natin. You can also utilize ang tinatawag nating pretense of physical evidence. So, when you say pretense of physical evidence, you pretend, okay? You pretend, the keyword is pretend, that a certain physical evidence has been found and the laboratory experts are examining it against him. So you might go to the suspect and you might say, confess ka na, mag-confess ka na lang kasi we found your semen coming from the crime scene. And I know the laboratory experts are examining it right now and I know that semen belongs to you. So by pretension that there is an evidence being obtained, the person might confess. The last one is jolting. Ang jolting po, ito po yung pwedeng ma-utilize natin on calm and nervous subjects. May mga nervyoso kasi tayo ng mga subjects. Ano ba mangyayari sa jolting? Jolting po, nagagalit ka. You raise the modulation of your voice. Nagagalit ka. And you appear as if you are on rage. But in reality, you are not. You are just pretending to be on rage. But take note po, ang jolting is only for calm and nervous subject. Yun po ang mga interrogation techniques that we can utilize in criminal investigation, particularly on the interrogation technique. However, marami pa po tayong interrogation techniques, but these are the most common ones. Okay, na pwede nating magagamit sa criminal investigation. Now, ang philosophy po ng interview and interrogation is very simple. The right officer asking the right questions in the right manner, at the right time, and in the right place will get the right answer. This cliche should be observed. So, pag ang right officer, an intelligent officer maybe, if you utilize right questions in a right approach at a very good timely manner, in the right place, conducive for interview or interrogation, and you will have the right answers. Yan po ang ibig sabihin ng philosophy of interview and interrogation. So review lang po natin, maikli lang po. Interview, para sa witnesses po yan, questioning of a subject who is cooperating. Interrogation, para po sa suspect, questioning to a suspect, and the suspect is not cooperating in the line of questioning. Yan po ang pagkakaiba sa interview at saka yung interrogation. Next, ang pangatlo po na eye or tool of investigation, ang tinatawag nating instrumentation. Now, pag basahin nyo po yung nasa slide, ibig sabihin po ng instrumentation, this refers actually to the totality or the sum total of all instruments in the detection of crime. For example, you might utilize polygraphy or polygraph, stereoscopic microscope. Maybe you will utilize bullet comparison microscope. So meaning in instrumentation, what you do is, you utilize a particular instrument in order to detect crime. So in cases where there are no significant physical evidences to be found, then the use of instrumentation is relatively unimportant. Kasi wala kang ebidensyang nakuha eh. For example, how will you know that the semen or the person raped the girl or the victim, if you do not get an evidence. If you get an evidence, say for example, you have the semen, then the semen could be subjected for instrumentation. And thereby you will know that the semen belongs to the perpetrator. Yan po ang importansya ng instrumentation as the last eye of investigation. Now, ang confession naman, tsaka yung admission, cadets, actually this is just a repetition sa criminal law. Kaya nga po, ang sabi ko sa mga nagre-review right now, ang masasabi ko sa inyo, ang mga topics po sa criminology, major subjects, are interrelated with each other. For example, ito, confession at admission, nasa criminal law po ito. Pero we will include this one in criminal investigation kasi nakalagay po sa CHED, tsaka yung sa PRC contest na may, you know, confession tsaka yung admission. Now, review lang po natin ha. Ang confession po is a direct acknowledgement of guilt. Okay? A direct acknowledgement of guilt. Ang admission naman po, tinatawag yung indirect. Indirect acknowledgement of guilt. When we say acknowledgement, you submit yourselves that accusation is true. You acknowledge. Okay? Again, confession, direct acknowledgement of guilt. Yung admission naman, indirect acknowledgement of guilt. Now, ang confession, dalawa lang po ang klase. Okay? We have two types. Extrajudicial, judicial confession. Ang extrajudicial po, ito po ang mga confession done outside the court. Done outside the court ha. For example, during custodial investigation, nag-confess po yung tao. Saan pa ginagawa ang custodial investigation? O dyan sa police station. Police station is outside the court. So basically, it's an extrajudicial confession. Pangalawa, judicial confession. Yung judicial confession is a confession being done in an open court. Meaning, this is the confession made in front of the judge or made inside the court. Now, may tinatawag tayong arraignment, di ba? Sa criminal procedure, marami pong lalabas sa criminal procedure, cadets. Dapat pagtuunan po nyo ng pansin ang criminal procedure. Now, sa criminal procedure po, pinaka-basic po dyan, arraignment po. Ano po ba ang arraignment? Dyan po magbibigay ng respond ang perpetrator whether he will plead guilty or not guilty of the offense. So, if the person will say, I am guilty, then that's a form of confession. If the person will tell the story about the crime, matatawag din po yung judicial confession so long as it is being done before the judge or inside the court. Now, as I have stated a while ago, ang admission is an indirect acknowledgement of guilt. Kaya nakalagay po dyan sa slide nyo na makikita ngayon ang first statement. A self-incriminatory statement by the subject falling short of acknowledgement of guilt. Now, we will differentiate more between the two para maintindihan po natin. Ang admission, it implicates but does not incriminate. Okay? Admission of guilt but lacks the detail of the elements of the crime. So meaning, para maintindihan po natin, when we say implicates, that refers to conveying a meaning. Conveying a meaning. It implicates but it does not incriminate. Admission will convey a meaning to the investigator but it does not mean that person is guilty of the accusation. For example, you keep on asking the individual and he just keep on being silent. There is what we call as admission by silence. Okay? Admission by silence. Silence, although can be a form of admission, but does not make a person guilty. Why? Because it only implicates, but it does not incriminate. When you say it does not incriminate, meaning it does not make a person guilty of the accusation. Now, Ang admission is acknowledgement of certain facts only. Take note, ha? Ang admission would only involve acknowledgement of certain facts. Pero ang confession is an acknowledgement of all the facts in the process of the commission of the crime. Yan po ang pinagkaiba ng confession at saka yung admission. Ang certain portion or certain portion of the story is admitted, tawag po niya admission. Pero pag lahat po, everything has been acknowledged by the perpetrator that he committed the crime and he performed it and, this, and the effect was this, the person died, and then it was investigated. Again, such acknowledgement can be considered as confession. Yan po ang pinakaiba ng confession tsaka yung admission. Now, in the taking of the admission and confession, sa lahat ng magiging kardodali sa dyan, pag-graduate, tandaan nyo po to, ha? Tandaan nyo po to. This is one of the reasons why sometimes cases left unsolved and cases sometimes became dismissed. The accused became acquitted because of this one. Dapat tandaan nyo po to, ha, sa magkardodali sa dyan. Rules to be observed in taking confession and admission. Una, it should be preferably in writing and under oath. Dapat notarize po yan, ha, in front of the lawyer. It must be written in a language known and understood by the accused. If not, it must be clearly translated. Ano ba ibig sabihin nito? Ang medium of communication po natin is English or Filipino. Now, pag ang tao is a Cebuano, Bisayang dako, Bisdak po. So dapat, yung confession niya should be in Bisdak. Should be in Bisaya, should be in Cebuano. Pero, ang requirement po natin is that there should be a translation. Dapat naka-attach po yung translation, Brad, yung English translation niya. Ha? Dapat isubmit mo yan. Pero yung confession niya in Cebuano, may naka-attach lang na translation. Pangatlo, dapat voluntary po yan. Freely and voluntary given by the accused. Freely and voluntary, ha? So pag you subjected the person to police brutality and the person confessed, nako, hindi po yan voluntary. Ha? Hindi po yan voluntary. So ang mangyayari dyan, hindi po yan maging admissible in the court. Or maybe you intimidate the person. You might say, ha, if you will go out, you will die if you will not confess. Ay, nako, hindi po pwede. Kasi it affects voluntariness in the part of the suspect. Pang-last po, ganito. Under the new constitution, it must be taken in the presence of a competent and independent counsel chosen by the accused. Okay, chosen by the accused. Under the new constitution, it must be taken in the presence of a competent and independent counsel chosen by the accused. So dapat po, ang sabi ko kanina, dapat may lawyer. So pag ang tao mag-confess, kuha ka ng lawyer or let the person select a lawyer. And the confession should be done within the presence of the counsel or the lawyer of the suspect. So ang rules natin na dapat nating tandaan, ha, in taking admission and confession. Now, punta naman tayo, cadets, sa mga methods of identification. Methods of identification by witness. May apat po tayo yung verbal description. Pag hindi po identified, kasi yung unang aim natin or yung unang phase ng criminal investigation is to identify the perpetrator. Now, pag hindi ma-identify, may apat po tayo na pamamaraan. Una, verbal description. So, verbal description would mean the description coming from the witness to describe the criminal. Baka sabihin ng witness, yung perpetrator po is mataba, tsaka maitim, that's a description. That's a verbal description. Pwede din po yung rogues gallery. Ano ba itong rogues gallery? Yung rogues gallery po is a database. It's a system containing the files of the suspect. So pwede din po sa photographic files natin i-determine yung identity ng perpetrator. Pag unidentified pa rin, wala sa rogues gallery, pwede din po yung general photograph. Sa general photograph po, The investigators show the witness the variety of facial types. The picture only represents different feature of the face. O, ano ba yung structure ng itsura niya? Malapad ba yung ilong? Matangos ba yung ilong? Yung mga ganito na mga aspects na ipapakita sa witness. And let the witness select what specific feature was the perpetrator that he saw. Yung last, yung artist assistance. When you say artist assistance, may tao po na tinatawag na artist na marunong mag-drawing. For example, sabihin mo, maitim yung buhok niya. Curly hair. So, i-sketch po yan ng artist. And usually, mabubuo yung image ng unidentified suspect. Now, if those four strategies may not work, you can proceed with the lineup. Ha? Mayroon po tayong tinatawag na lineup, ha? Una natin tandaan, ang lineup po consist of 7 to 10 persons. Okay, take note. Ilan po ba ang tao? 7 to 10 persons. Pangalawa, witness is instructed before entering the lineup room to the fact that the suspect is among the persons in the group. Okay, he should be instructed na nandyan yung suspect sa room. Pangatlo, the lineup members, yung 7 hanggang 10, should be instructed not to talk unless voice recognition is required. Pero pag walang voice recognition, they should not be allowed to talk. Pang-apat, the witness desires the lineup members to perform certain actions, then he should communicate this information discreetly. Ano ibig sabihin ng discreetly? Secretly, ha? In secret to the investigator. So pag sabihin ng witness na, I want them to dance. Because by letting them dance, I can identify who is that particular suspect. So, you have to inform this kind of request or you have to tell this request secretly with the investigator. Now, if there is more than one witness, they should make their identification separately. Why? In order to avoid, again, duplication or replication of ideas. Now, generally speaking, the 7 to 10 persons po, dapat same height po yan, same hair color, yung clothing niya is the same. The same po in appearance. Yan po ang general rule of thumb in police lineup. Now, another thing is on circumstantial evidence. Okay, this is a repetition ha, sa criminal law. But I have to emphasize this because this is part of the course contents of CHED and PRC. Ang circumstantial evidence, from the word circumstantial, circumstances, meaning this refers to events and circumstances that can be considered as an evidence. Now, circumstantial evidence is identification established indirectly by proving other facts or circumstances from which either alone or in connection with the other facts, the identity of this perpetrator can be inferred. For example, love triangle between Pedro, Juan, and Maria. So the love triangle could be a circumstantial evidence. For example, Maria died and it was known that Maria was being raped. Okay? He was being raped. So the love triangle could be a circumstantial evidence. Or maybe Pedro died by means of stabbing. So the love triangle could be a circumstantial evidence to pinpoint who want to be the suspect of that particular crime. Tawag po dyan, circumstantial evidence. Ang tanong ngayon, pwede ba, maging sufficient ba ang circumstantial evidence to produce conviction? Sufficient ba ang circumstantial evidence to produce conviction? Ano po ang sagot? Ang sagot po is, it can be sufficient. It can be, pwede po maging sufficient yan to produce conviction. Pero, in order for circumstantial evidence to produce conviction, take note po, cadet, dapat more than one circumstance po. Dapat more than one circumstance yan para makaproduce ka ng conviction. Pangalawa, when the facts from which the inferences derived are proven. Ano ba ibig sabihin nito? Kung love triangle ang circumstantial evidence mo, dapat there should be a proof that will prove that there is really an existence of that love triangle. Pangatlo, If you will combine the circumstances, kasi more than one yan eh. If you will combine the different circumstances, it would be enough to produce a conviction beyond reasonable doubt. So pag na-meet po yung requirements na mga yan, pwede po ang circumstantial evidence can be enough to produce conviction. Now, the question right now is, what must be inferred to prove identity by circumstantial evidence? Pwede ba na malaman mo yung identity ng perpetrator by means of circumstantial evidence? Maybe. If this is the situation po, one person is running. He's holding with him a knife, and that knife is stained with blood. And his t-shirt is also stained with blood. And he's running from a particular corner. And when you happen to go to that corner, you saw a dead body of the individual. Okay? Oozing with blood, with stab wounds. Even though you did not see the person or that guy running with a knife in his hand, kahit hindi mo yan nakikita on the act of the performance of the stabbing incident, it will give you a circumstantial evidence, an idea, na possibly ang tao that runs, that escaped from that corner, was actually the one who perpetrated the crime. So, ma-establish yung identity. Pero, dapat po makikita dito ang mga elements na tinatawag nating motive, intent, tsaka yung opportunity, at tsaka yung iba. When you say motive po, this refers to a factor that pushes the person to commit the act. For example, jealousy. The love triangle, pwede po yan. Hatred, vengeance, pwede po as a motive that will push the person to commit the act. Ang accomplishment of the act, ang tawag po dyan, intent. Kuha niyo po, motive, something that pushed the person to commit the act. Intent is the accomplishment of the act. Opportunity, on the other hand, is the physical possibility that the suspect could have been committed a crime. It may be deduced from the following. Suspect could have been in the vicinity of the crime, knowledge of the criminal objectives, and the absence of alibi. By the way, sa korte po, ang alibi, tinatawag po yung weakest evidence. Weakest form of evidence in the court. Now, so pag may motive, may intent, may opportunity po, pwede po siya magagamit to infer and to prove the identity of the suspect. Last, pag hindi po ma-identify yung suspect through circumstantial, through lineup, through rogues gallery, through artist sketch, so on and so forth. Pag hindi po ma-identify, lastly, we can utilize what we call as physical evidences. We can actually identify persons. Kasi pag ang tao ng rape, tapos he is not identified, but the semen of that person is left at the crime scene. My goodness, you can have that semen and identify him. So by the use of physical evidences, pwede pong ma-identify ang persons. Ang tanong ngayon, ano ba ibig sabihin ng physical evidence? Physical evidence, these are articles and materials which are found in connection with the investigation and in aid establishing the identity of the suspect. These are tangible, ha? Tangible, can be touched, can be seen. Articles and materials that can be used as an evidence. These evidences are found in the crime scene. Now, tatlo po yan. Corpus delicti evidence, associated evidence, at saka yung tracing evidence. Mga kadete, yung corpus delicti very common po, di ba? Sabihin natin, the dead body of the person. The body of the person, or the body of the crime rather. The body of the crime, I'm sorry. It's body of the crime. Corpus delicti, the body of the crime. Question right now is, what is body of the crime? When can you say that it's the body? When you say corpus delicti, it does not literally refer to the physical body. But rather, this refers to the elements of the crime po. Elements of the crime. For example, yung theft. Theft na krimen. Hindi naman po pwede sabihin mo na ang corpus delicti evidence of theft is the dead body of the victim. Kasi sa theft, walang dead body po. Ang sa theft po, ang nawawala dyan is yung item, yung property. So yung property is one of the corpus delicti evidence that will prove that there is theft. Kuha nyo po. Pero pag ang crimine is homicide, eh, ang homicide is killing of the individual eh. So, dapat may dead body kung consummated homicide. Pero kung frustrated, of course, walang dead body yung frustrated homicide. So, ibig sabihin dyan, yung mga elements of the crime, yun po ang magiging corpus delicti evidence. If it is a burglary, yung sira na doorknob, yung sira na jealousy, yun po pwede magiging corpus delicti evidence po yan to prove that there is burglary. So, again, body of the crime ha, corpus delicti po. Ang ibig sabihin ng body of the crime, these are the elements that needs to be proved. Pangalawa, yung fingerprint, take note po, in 2010, criminology licensure examination. Pangatlo po, tatlong beses, lumabas po to. Ang fingerprint po is an associative evidence. Okay? These are pieces of evidence that will link the suspect to the crime scene. Weapons, tools, garments, or prints. Tracing evidence, on the other hand, are articles which assist the investigator in locating the criminal. Stolen goods in the possession of the suspect is an example of a tracing evidence. Or another example, para maintindihan yung tracing evidence tsaka yung associative evidence. Yung mga blood stains, footprints, ito po mga associative evidence po ito. Pero, pag ang tao wala na sa crime scene, okay, for example, rape yung case, wala na siya sa crime scene, andun na siya sa bahay niya. And as the investigator, when you go to his house, you saw the shoes of the person. And when you examine the shoes of the person, may nakikita ka na soil deposited on the shoes of the person. And when you examine that soil, it so happened that that soil is of the same quality with the soil of the crime scene. Diba? So ang soil taken from the shoes of the person as an evidence can be considered as a tracing evidence that will prove nga ang tao na yan was there at the crime scene. Kasi iba yung soil quality ng sa bahay nila tsaka yung soil quality ng crime scene. And you found out that the soil quality deposited in the shoes is actually coming from the crime scene. So the soil in that instance is a tracing evidence. Yan po ang pinagkaiba ng corpus delicti, associative evidence, tracing evidence. Last, in order to introduce physical evidence in court, in order to introduce, para maging admissible yan sa korte. You listen up, Cardo Dalisay people. Para maging admissible yan, it's either corpus, associative, or tracing. For it to be produced in the court, dapat po ma-accomplish natin itong mga requirements na to. Number one, dapat properly identified po yan, properly preserved din po. Di ba may markings tayo sa evidence preservation? Pangalawa, chain of custody must be proved. Di ba you will be transferring your evidence from you to the other person? Dapat naka-establish po yung chain of custody. Kasi pag hindi po yan na-establish ang chain of custody, patay tayo. Hindi yan magagamit sa korte. Pangatlo, the evidence must be material and relevant. Ibig sabihin po dyan, dapat yung ebidensya mo is related to the case being investigated. Hindi naman po pwede na mag-present ka ng painting tapos yung krimen mo is homicide. Or maybe the crime is illegal. And you are presenting the court with a knife. Di po pwede. So that has to be relevant or material in the court. Mga cadets, sa nagre-review online, I would like to stop in this slide muna. We'll be breaking the discussion into 3 episodes para at least I can give you time to relax. Yung sa second episode po, okay, yung sa second episode will be on crime scene investigation proper na. Yung topics. Importante din po that you have to review. You go with the discussion in episode 2 kasi importante din po yon. Lahat ng mga discussion na nasa episode 2 is aligned with PRC and CHED na pwede magagamit nyo sa board examination. So for now, let's have a short relaxation after a couple of hours. Thank you so much. Let's make sure I hope you pass the board.